Yeah, this is chapter 26. Chapter 14. Okay, so reproduction is when we end up creating a new individual through existing ones, through our parents, an offspring from our parents. There's external fertilization. External fertilization is when the parents actually release gametes into the environment, and that's where the fertilization actually occurs. And as you can see, this frog here, they release their eggs, and then the male will release their sperm into the environment, and that's where fertilization occurs. Yeah, they release their eggs into the water, and then the sperm is also released into the water as well. And in that water medium, that's where the sperm will be able to reach the eggs. Yeah. Versus internal fertilization, which we do as well, is where we have these land animals, that terrestrial animals, that will end up depositing the sperm into the female's body. And that's where fertilization occurs in the female's body. There's also these three types of reproduction we'll get into. One is asexual, the other one's sexual, and finally we have the mixed reproduction. Asexual reproduction, we should already know this by now since we were doing this last week in lab. It's when we have the offsprings that are genetically identical with its parent because they are... basically are coming from the parent themselves. One way is to do this is through this budding process, and this is when you have an outgrowth from the parent, as shown over here. In this hydra here, now this outgrowth comes off of the parent and splits off to become an offspring, a complete individual in itself. Another way of asexual reproduction is this process called fission. And as you can see, the sea anemone is undergoing fission. So this is when the parent actually separates from itself to form two offsprings that are the same size as the parent itself. While this budding off, notice it's a lot smaller, right? The fission here is when they actually complete this process, they become two similar sized organisms.
So if something buds off, can it become fission, or is it at the time of the separation it's the same size? That's what makes it fission?
Yeah, at the time when they separate and they're around the same size, that's fission, versus budding off is when there's just a smaller portion of the from the parent side that breaks off.
Okay.
26 now. Finally, we have fragmentation. And fragmentation is when we have a portion of the parent's body that's broken off, and then that part that was broken off will regenerate and form a complete individual. While the part that was broken off from the original parent also regenerates and just forms that limb, though. So, for example, is the sea star here. Notice how one of the arms of the sea star was broken off, and however it was reformed now, but this one that was broken off, if there's enough of its body in place, it will form into a complete sea star itself. That's nasty. Okay, sorry, I was just... There are some advantages of being asexual. One is that you don't have to spend that much time and energy to pursue or produce gametes, to pursue after a mate or produce gametes. So you don't need to... Yes, Star Trek. The other advantage is that you could still reproduce even if you are isolated. So if even by yourself, you're able to reproduce.
Is that like a
No, this is a hydra still. It's a animal more than anything else. It's just a very small animal in the ocean kind of thing. Also, the other advantage is that you could reproduce very rapidly. You don't have to wait for the sperm to fertilize the egg and then cause that zygote to grow into the complete individual. So you can reproduce very rapidly, and also if you reproduce very rapidly, you can exploit the resources around that area and take most of that resources there. However, disadvantages is that there's no genetic variation, right? It's exact copy of the parent itself. And if there is some sort of environmental change that causes that particular individual not to suit well for that individual, if that environmental change occurs, then not only does that parent die, but all its offsprings as well, because they're genetically identical to the parent. Oh, sorry. For sexual reproduction, this is when you actually have an offspring that's formed after two individuals reproduce with one another. So here we have the gametes, and we already talked about how the gametes. What does haploid mean again? Anyone remember? We are diploid, right? And how many chromosomes do we have? We have 46, 23 pairs, right? And haploid, on the other case, has how many chromosomes if we're talking about our own sperm or eggs? 23 chromosomes, okay? So they only have one set of chromosomes, while us being diploid has two sets, one from our mom's side, one from our dad's side. No, we're talking about how these gametes are haploid cells, our sperm and eggs are haploid cells, and when we undergo sexual reproduction, we are forming a diploid cell. Mm-hmm. So sperm is the male gamete, egg is the female gamete. Zygote, once again, is that fertilized egg, when that sperm fertilizes the egg to form that cell, that fertilized cell. And once we have this zygote, this is when we have that diploid cell. And from here on out, it'll undergo mitosis, which we'll talk about in the next lecture. And whenever I talk about haploid, it's also denoted as N, a single N, while diploid is usually denoted as 2N. So advantages of sexual reproduction? Variety, right? We already talked about how through crossing over, through random fertilization, and through a random assortment, this helps increase the amount of variety that to develop in our offspring, so that we could, if there's some kind of environmental change, we hopefully have someone with certain traits to be able to survive that environmental change. Disadvantage, we already talked about it, how it does take more time and energy to find a mate and also to produce these gametes. I don't buy that. Oh, sorry. Finally, we have mixed reproduction. Mixed reproduction. This is when some animals can reproduce either asexually or sexually. Sea anemones are like that. Anemones. So sea anemones, they could reproduce asexually, like through what process again? We talked about that before. No, it's through... How does it reproduce asexually? Yeah, what is... Starts with the F. Fission, yeah, very good. And over here, you see the sea anemone releasing eggs, so this is trying to reproduce sexually here. Hermaphrodites, these are individuals with both male and female reproductive systems. So tapeworms have that hermaphroditic ability, and also earthworms themselves. And there are also hermaphrodites in humans as well due to, it does occur. Yeah, the thing is they're not functional. Not necessarily. It just depends. I don't know. They might be sterile. I don't know for sure if they actually are sterile or not, kind of thing. I think that might be a rumor.
Or Lady Gaga.
Lady Gaga, never mind. Okay. Advantage is going... Talking about mixed reproduction app, what are the advantages of it? Well, we said that they could reproduce either asexually or sexually. So when the environment is stable and there's no changes, it's more beneficial for them to reproduce asexually because they don't have to spend time making gametes. They don't have to spend time finding mates. So they end up reproducing a lot quicker to exploit the resources available. However, if the conditions or environment starts to change, they might want to switch to sexual reproduction. That way we end up increasing the amount of variety of offsprings that we have, or that they have, and so that those offsprings have a better chance of surviving that changed environment. I don't know if those are really different species of sea anemone. I just found different colors of them. To give you an example. What was your question? Yeah, I think Nemo did. The clownfishes, they had this, what do you call it? Symbiotic relationship with the sea anemone. Definitely.